Picking up right after the events of last episode, where Cell, freshly revived for some reason, was able to come in and save Goku, Vegeta, Cumber, and Hearts from the exploding copy version of Planet Vegeta and the wrath of the weirdly revived Goku Black, who is not dead? We saw mysterious figures that Cell was apparently working with, only for those mysterious figures to turn out to be Gohan, Krillin 17 and 18 for some reason, and it's kind of odd to see 17 and 18 in the same shot as Cell. It's weird. But of course, none of them trust him. They're wondering, what are you up to, Cell? Why are you here? Like, of course, Vegeta would have the same kind of animosity towards Cell that he had towards Frieza after everything that they've been through with these characters. He's not really cool with the whole, these characters keep coming back from the dead. Although I would honestly love to see a rematch between Gohan and Cell. But as it turns out, the person who brought Cell back from the dead was, in fact, Shroom. Shroom is a demon god and a member of the Dark Empire who served under Muchikubura. He's also a god of death or Grim Reaper, so him being able to revive someone from the dead is kind of to be expected. We also see that he's working with Salsa, which makes sense because they also served under Michikabura, you know, the master of all the demon worlds, who was defeated by Trunks during that one episode and sealed in time. So that does bring forward the question, why would they be working with these heroes? Although, to be honest, their primary enemies are the Time Patrol versions of Goku and Vegeta, not so much these ones. But regardless, it does raise a lot of questions. See, it would be one thing if those two were working on their own, but they're working with Poonteen, who had kind of been betrayed by Michikabura, who tried to absorb their energy. And I've been under the assumption that, you know, during the final battle, while Shroom and Salsa seem to continue to want to serve under Michikabura, Deborah, Poutine, and Gravy, they were absorbed into Michikabura to bolster his power, and, you know, thought they were kind of dead after that fact, but then Poutine showed up with Demigra in this series, who was someone she originally followed along with Gravy back in the day, fighting against the Supreme Time Kai of Time, Corona. So it made me think, okay, Poutine is siding with Demigra because she wasn't really chill with a lot of things that Michikabura was doing. But now she's working with Salsa and Shroom, which really makes me wonder what Demigra's whole plan for this is. Is Demigra being betrayed? Is Poutine, you know, living up to the nickname she ended up getting as Two-Faced Poutine? And I thought she got that nickname because she turned on Demigra, who wasn't really chill with Michikabura, but apparently she's working with Demigra, so I'm like, what's the angle here? Are they working towards reviving Michikabura, getting him out of that, the seal that he's in, or are they working with Demigra? Like, a lot of things are unclear with the demons in this series. It's really getting out of hand. And why they care about this issue specifically, as Shroom explains, that they're here to try to stop Black. Apparently, Black is still trying to enact the Zero Mortals plan. You know, that old chestnut. And he plans to use the power of this mirror dimension created by Few, where anything that happens here also affects Universe 7. And apparently he plans on destroying the mortals in this world in order to eliminate the mortals in the actual Universe 7 altogether. Meanwhile, Cell is thinking, you know, I don't really intend to be in on all of this combat and so on and so forth. In fact, it's obvious that he's got a double cross in mind. But Hearts with his weird abilities that are all over the place, was actually able to hear Cell's thoughts. But he doesn't reveal what Cell is up to. So it's not clear if Hearts is proposing a team-up between the two of them, since they're still both technically dead, or if Hearts plans to stop him when the time is right. Got a lot of moving parts for such a simple series. Like, it's weird how complicated all of this is really starting to get, because technically we're an arc within an arc. We still have Few to deal with who has all the powers of Michigabora. And it's still wildly unclear why Toa, who served under Michigabora, who seemed to want to get her brother Deborah back on the throne of the demon world, who despite being seen as a traitor to the demon world, you know, wanted to break the demon world free and unleash it, who made this Cell-like entity Mira to, you know, become the top dog of the demon realm, who resurrected Michigabora and seemed to want to put him on top. Do you get where I'm going with this? There's too much going on in all of this. Like, are these motherfuckers just after the power that Michigabora could unleash inside of them? Because they were able to reach some very high heights of power. And Toa was only able to re-reach her demon goddess form when Fu had the power of Michigabora. Too many wheels within wheels within wheels. But regardless, Gohan asks Goku about, you know, maybe we can use Ultra Instinct to take him down this time. You know, you didn't have that power before when you fought him. Not really knowing about how things went down last time, but that is a question. You know, Goku asks Vegeta, you haven't really adapted to that new blue berserker state you got going on, so, you know, maybe we need to work on that a little bit, but we don't really have the time so much. That's when Poutine, Salsa, and Shroom create this kind of alternate world, similar to the Room of Spirit and Time, where they'll be able to train by finding figments of people they've fought in the past in order to get a little bit stronger and work on their new transformations and all that good stuff. Very convenient, but apparently it takes all three of the demons to create this kind of alternate space. It's funny too, because I wonder if they could have just sealed Goku and Vegeta away to be done with them. I kept thinking maybe this is a trick, but nah, it's legit. And apparently, Shroom is also working with someone else who will keep Goku Black at bay until Goku and Vegeta are ready to join the fight. And so Goku and Vegeta enter, and they face off against some very familiar faces. Meanwhile, Goku Black, I'm very unclear about this scene. He seems to unleash this energy that creates these proxies of people within the mortal realm. Well, the other universe, Universe 7. But before he can do anything, in comes the Saiyan in Black, basically, who tries to put a stop to what Goku Black is up to. And of course, Goku Black explains his devious machinations that by unleashing this power within this universe and creating these copies of all these various mortals, he'll be able to kill mortals at his leisure without interference. But it's kinda like, man, you got a lot of interference going on right now, so what you talking about? And then the figure in black turns into a Super Saiyan, and it's just like, okay, who is this guy? I mean, he's voiced by Masako Nozawa, so, you know, Masako Nozawa continues to take up the majority of the voice cast in this series, from the mysterious Saiyan in black, to Goku Black, to Gohan, to Goku. You just need friggin' Goten up in this, and it's just a smorgasbord. Get back friggin' Turles. Just make it the whole crew. Yo, bring in Bardock, why don't ya? Meanwhile, Hearts and the rest are ready to head out and help out the warrior in black, only for Dr. W to show up with Bojack and Super 17 in a mask. I'm kinda questioning that one. Like, is it a time-breaker mask for androids? And, I mean, that's gonna be an interesting matchup, seeing Super 17 go up against current 17 and 18, and maybe Krillin, and maybe Gohan can fight Bojack? Like, weird stuff be happening. Also, we have the startling revelation that Dr. W is, in fact, Dr. Wheelo. As his flesh melts off his body in a really disgusting manner. And Wheelo powers up into Super Wheelo! In a more compact version of, the body from World Strongest. And while part of me wants to question how he could possibly be strong enough to take on our heroes, the fact that 17 was able to, you know, get so much stronger, you know, and Cell in general, like, the powers that most of these forms of technology in the Dragon Ball world has never made any real sense, rhyme, or reason, so I'm just gonna roll with it. And interestingly enough, Gohan decides that he'll be the one to take this dude on, and we actually get a fight of Gohan versus Wheelo, and I'm just like, oh snap, we're actually giving Gohan something to do. Friggin' far out, man. I mean, Wheelo is definitely a jobber and he's gonna lose immediately, but I'm just like, oh snap, they're actually giving Gohan a chance to shine, if only for a brief moment. Meanwhile, we get this really well animated fight between the Warrior in Black and Goku Black. I mean, like, it's really kind of fascinating. I'm not used to seeing them put this much effort into a fight in this series. And I really am wondering who this Saiyan is, because he seems like just another Goku clone, but then he has these notable scars on both of his hands, and I'm just like, okay, what does that mean? And how and why is he working with Shroom, a demon? Like, it raises so many questions. And speaking of raising questions, Goku Black transforms into Super Saiyan Rose 3? Because I think Goku Black was fighting in Rose 2 for a little while there, but it was really hard to tell because, I mean, come on. Saiyan and Super Saiyan look so similar. But 3 is very distinct. And, yeah, him going into 3, he immediately kicks the Warrior in Black to the curb, which, it's just like, you had to go to 3 to do that? He was only in Super Saiyan, though. Like, was this guy really giving you that much trouble, dude? And then Goku Black is ready to finish him off, but he's interrupted by the arrival of Goku and Vegeta. Meanwhile, Gohan got a W against Dr. W, so good for him. I'm just glad to see Gohan get a win in for once. Like, good on Gohan. You gotta win. But meanwhile, Goku Black sees the arrival of Goku and Vegeta, and he's just like, yeah, but, you know, I beat you guys once, I'll do it again. But Goku and Vegeta are looking like, yeah, it's not gonna be the same thing twice. As Goku's in perfected Ultra Instinct, and, I'm just gonna say this in the simplest way, Vegeta's in Super Saiyan Blue, controlled Berserker, or something along those lines. Why they couldn't just let Vegeta have his Blue evolution, or evolved, or transcended form, and have that powered up a little bit, I'm very unclear on, but, you know, whatever, at least Vegeta's getting a little shine. Also, they now have the insignia of the Time Breakers on their outfit, which, given the history we've had with those insignias, it feels kind of weird. But I can't really say that about Super Dragon Ball Heroes. It's been weird, it's gonna continue to be weird, and this whole story arc is just odd, because it's just like, what is Few doing while we're dicking around in this alternate dimension? Why do we keep cutting away from Few? Now, I wouldn't have so much of a problem with this if we would just deal with Few already, instead of constantly going on these side missions. I thought we were starting to reach a conclusion, but we keep getting sidetracked, and I'm just like, guys, come on. What's the rhyme or reason or direction for all of this? What are you doing? But that's neither here nor there. Let me know your feelings in the comment section below. What did you think about the win Gohan was finally able to get? What did you think about Super Saiyan Rose 2 and 3? Do you feel that they were necessary, or are you okay with those inclusions? What do you think the machinations of the demon race of Shroom, Salsa, Poutine, what are they up to? Seriously. When is Cell going to turn coat and betray them all? What will Hearts end up doing? And will these powered up forms of Goku and Vegeta be enough to once again stop the Zero Mortals plan? Because, I mean, they never really did completely defeat Zamasu before, so I guess this is another chance for them to do the deed. It just feels unfortunate that Trunks isn't here, given the fact that Goku Black was kind of his enemy for the most part, and now it's the Goku and Vegeta show once again. God, I just can't stop complaining, but again, let me know your thoughts in the comment section below. If you like this video, please like, comment, subscribe, and hit the bell icon for notifications. And until next time, I've been Doozdizden, and I will see you later. Bye-bye.